Hi. Love you too, man. That was really nice. I'm going to bring this up to my height. So you see I'm in the middle. I'm not standing in the way of the slides because I don't do slides. I don't think we look and listen with equal efficiency at the same time. And I know that in my brief student days, I'm a college dropout, you know, that slide lectures, I'd go directly to sleep. And now I can see you, so if you go to sleep, I'll point you out. Also, I don't lecture. I guess because I didn't attend them and I've never been an academic, I don't understand lecturing. I understand writing and I understand talking. It seems to me lectures are a combination of sloppy writing and tight-ass talking. So what I'm going to do is read writing and then we'll talk. That's my favorite part, the Q&A. We'll talk about art or related matters and questions, comments, attacks. I don't know, I'm from New York, we're supposed to be tough. By the way, Calvin Tompkins is still writing at the New Yorker. He does profiles of artists. He wrote a great one about Charles Ray last year, which I thought was exceptional. I don't know that he would ever have called himself a critic. He was more a kind of journalist that is, you know, characteristic of the New Yorker and not very many other places where you do an article and you work on it for 9 months and then give birth. I don't do those very often. I find that I've been a columnist of one kind or another for between 40 and 50 years. And so anything over about 1,400 words and I get nosebleeds. That was a joke. Anyway, so I'm going to read a speech, really, that I have used before. I keep tinkering with it. It says most of what I feel I can say about what I do and may lead into other things. And it is called The Critic. It's my stump speech, basically. So. The Critic as Artist, updating Oscar Wilde. Oscar Wilde's The Critic as Artist, published in 1890, manifests art criticism as a branch of what is called, often dismissively, belles lettres. It's not an easy read. It is dauntingly long. And has anybody here read it? Anybody here read The Critic as Artist by Oscar Wilde? Wow. Due for a comeback here. It is dauntingly long and congested with purple rhetorical flights and flourishes. Wilde flaunts his knowledge and sophistication in a blizzard of references, variously obvious or obscure today, to art and artists throughout history. I suspect that the display excited readers in the 1890s as a sort of house tour of a fully and beautifully furnished mind in the latest art for art's sake fashion. Now it's somewhat like a period room in a museum behind a velvet rope. But along the way, Wilde mounts razor-edged assaults on dreary, timid, deadening attitudes toward art of kinds that have changed in form over 126 years, but never die. While praising beauty, he demonstrates its utility as a weapon. I pledge allegiance to Oscar Wilde's model of art criticism. The model promotes intelligence and energy in culture, as all criticism should, while making the exercise as little forbidding and boring as possible. It posits pleasures of the text as a rightful expectation of readers. This is very echoey, isn't it? Is everyone following? Okay. I'm listening to myself and it's, you know, it's kind of spooky. promotes intelligence and energy and culture, as all criticism should, while making the exercise as little forbidding and boring as possible. It posits pleasures of the text as a rightful expectation of readers. It is autobiographical. Ideas and even facts, as well as feelings, register as events in a life. The speaker both is and isn't the writer. While going by the names I and me, the critic as artist is a fictional being, mysteriously hell-bent for self-cultivation and never tired or confused. No one knows better the flimsiness of that illusion than any actual writer who is often tired and regularly confused. He or she bets that readers, if pleasurably engaged, will condone the masquerade. The critic as artist conveys heightened states of mind. Not really belonging to the writer, the states are available to the reader. A name for the transaction is style. Critics as artists are stylists, in key with tastes of their times. They operate in the flashing present where everybody lives. Inevitably, if not terminally, they become dated. In exceptional cases, such as that of Wilde, the meat of what they say outlasts its sizzle. In dialogue, a pleasant character named Ernest advances popular beliefs, and a smart aleck named Gilbert shoots them down. Says Ernest, "Why should the artist be troubled by the shrill clamor of criticism? Why should those who cannot create take upon themselves to estimate the value of creative work? What can they know about it?" Gilbert's answers go beyond a defense of art criticism as a professional pursuit to a case for independent thought as an ethical imperative. He begins by pointing out that artists themselves function critically in what they choose to do and not to do. They are critics narrowly but deeply focused on their own concerns. Their decisions become history. Says Gilbert, "There never has been a creative age that has not been critical also, for it is the critical faculty that invents new forms. The tendency of creation is to repeat itself. It is to the critical instinct that we owe each new school that springs up, each new mold that art finds ready to its hand." Another critic as artist, Gertrude Stein, once said, quote, "Artists don't need criticism, they need appreciation. If they need criticism, they aren't artists." This true statement supports Wilde's view. Proper art criticism is not directed to artists. Sensing this can make some artists grumpy. Gilbert goes on, "I am aware that there are many honest workers in painting, as well as in literature, who object to criticism entirely. They are quite right. Their work stands in no intellectual relation to their age. It brings us no new element of pleasure. It suggests no fresh departure of thought or passion or beauty. It should not be spoken of. It should be left to the oblivion that it deserves." There is a world of significance in Wilde's phrase, intellectual relation to their age. I will dwell on it. I don't think it refers to the value of critical ideas in themselves, much less to systems of ideas. Intellectual systems antagonize critics as artists. In turn, adherents of systems tend to regard such critics, if at all, as mosquito-like nuisances. I speak as one who is used to being swatted by academics. Intellectual systems stand in relation not to their ages, but to previous ones. Clement Greenberg consolidated his program of modernism in the late 1950s, just in time for pop and minimalist artists to demolish it with up-to-date critical perception. The set of beliefs called postmodernism arose on a wave of nostalgia for the glory days of that and earlier demolitions. Marcel Duchamp kept being hauled from his grave and sent zombie-like against some or another imaginary oppression. The key word in Wilde's phrase, intellectual relation, is relation. Thought that pays its way by coaxing meaning from encounters with reality. The effect is temporary. It involves ideas only as instruments. No idea is true in itself. Truth happens to an idea when it clarifies an experience. Then its work is done. It may prove useful again. I think of Charles Baudelaire's definition of beauty as a spark between something fleeting and something timeless. That idea never wears out for me. But it is true only intermittently when beauty happens. Then it goes back to being words on a page. I've mentioned a natural antagonism between artists who want appreciations, who want appreciation, and critics who criticize. Gilbert dramatizes it in a fairly jolting passage that ends with what, for critics, has to be the most comforting sentence in the essay. Says Gilbert, "Bad artists always admire each other's work. They call it being large-minded and free from prejudice. But a truly great artist cannot conceive of life being shown or beauty fashioned under any conditions other than those that he has selected. Creation employs all its critical faculty within its own sphere. It may not use it in the sphere that belongs to others. It is exactly because a man cannot do a thing that he is the proper judge of it. That is, the inept man or woman is free to slip in and out of the minds of artists whose mastery is, besides a kind of palace, a kind of prison. The unskilled must bow to skill, of course. I hope always to keep in mind that I'm unqualified to understand the works of artists in the ways that they do. However, I can understand it in a way that they don't, as myself, whoever that is on a given occasion. Like the artist, the critic creates and affirms value to the degree of his or her individuality. This is a rule without exceptions. Says Gilbert, there is no fine art without self-consciousness, and self-consciousness and the critical spirit are one. For there is no art where there is no style, and no style where there is no unity, and unity is of the individual. No doubt Homer had old ballads and stories to deal with, as Shakespeare had chronicles and plays from which to work, but they were merely his rough materials. He took them and shaped them into song. I think that is or should be common sense. Both good art and good criticism employ self-consciousness as a workaday tool. We model our thoughts and feelings to ourselves as if they were actors and we were directors auditioning them. Many we reject out of hand, some we schedule for callbacks, and a few we hire on the spot. If we are writers, we keep framing sentences in our minds, each with a tone of confidence and conviction, even when a moment's reflection proves it lame or wrong. We grope for a sentence that advances the argument we're making, reads well, and we hope surprises us. We live to be surprised. Okay, it's a job. Critics toil within editorial constraints, which affect our styles. In an otherwise fantastically generous essay on me in the New York Review of Books, the critic as artist Sanford Schwartz decided that my writing was more fun before I joined the New Yorker. For all I know, that's true, but you will not hear me complain about working for the New Yorker. Says Gilbert, pressing the point about individuality home, it is only by intensifying his own personality that the critic can interpret the personality and work of others. And the more strongly this personality enters into the interpretation, the more real the interpretation becomes, the more satisfying, the more convincing, and the more true. That's tricky if you're not Oscar Wilde. Not many of us have personalities that are integral and robust enough to carry the full weight of an argument. So we must pretend that we are. A famous declaration of Rimbaud, je suis un autre, I as somebody else, seems to me a normal condition for persuasive writing. We comb out our sorry selves to activate better ones. I'm always glad when someone praises my work, but at times I've been uneasy as if I had gotten away with something. I want to say, that wasn't me. A former actress to whom I married long ago taught me the right response. She said, smile and say thank you. And she added, keep moving. Having known a number of savvy performers, actors, comedians, musicians, has instructed me in this regard by osmosis. By the way, I believe that frequent attendance at theater, cabaret, and music events, as well as dance, and if you can afford it, opera, is the best nourishment for a critical sensibility, as reading other critics is the worst. Those are arts embodied by and for real people in real time. They can form visceral memories which set standards for private looking and reading. Let's remember that Wilde's most pronounced genius was for the stage. Criticism is a performing art, sort of a minor performing art, like stand-up comedy. Compared to more directly creative artists, we may be role-bound functionaries, but the tighter the space in which you can swing your arms, the more precious is your liberty to do so. Every good artist is an outsider artist in a way that counts. And every good critic is an outsider critic in a way that counts. Good art and good criticism are not practices, that horrible word so prevalent in art babble lately. Practices are professional specialties. Associated with art, the word assumes settled social agreement on what artists do. This may comfort the moms and dads of art students, casting their children's choice of career as akin to medicine or the law. Like all jargon, it lets us rattle on about something without feeling and thereby doubting the truth and value of what we say. The life of art is a renegade passion that scraps the menu of standard occupations in a society. I don't insist on myths of the bohemian rebel or the holy fool, though there is recurrent truth in them. Independence of spirit doesn't rule out a worldly wise career with dealers and assistants in a house in the country, but I do insist that an original burning dissatisfaction likely ignited in early childhood distinguishes artists from their fellow citizens. The same goes for critics as artists. Lastingly majestic about Oscar Wilde is his outsiderness at the center of creative culture in his time. His Irishness, gayness, dandyism, and erudition, laced with the feel for trends of a crack journalist, gave him an outsider's angle on the society that he inhabited and adorned. His wit still startles by registering lightning descents from conventional wisdom that didn't know it was conventional yet. He omits what he contradicts, leaving us to supply it. An unexamined assumption is destroyed, throwing us off balance. We must think a new thought to right ourselves. Wilde's high-wire act couldn't succeed indefinitely because reliant on a nimble perception of cultural change moment to moment, he likely would have stumbled in the age of cubism. Like his rivalrous friend Whistler, he was fully modern, but on a British sidetrack of the Continental Modernity Express. The cause of his fall didn't have to be an untimely mishap of hubris, which gave people whom he had outraged the chance to destroy him. In brief, he sued a man for calling him homosexual, which defense lawyers proved in court that he was. He was jailed for 3 years and died in poverty of cerebral meningitis in 1900, 46 years old. The tragedy had one good effect. It afforded a naked view of the real Oscar Wilde beneath the gaudy masquerade, a serious, decent, brave man. His aplomb survived it all. As he lay dying in an ugly hotel room, he was heard to say, "Either this wallpaper goes, or I do." The critic as artist Dave Hickey has noted that when two curators agree, that's a trend, but when two critics agree, one of them is redundant. Bringing to bear and even exaggerating our peculiarities is both the pleasure and the duty of dedicated critics. Readers should not be able to predict with precision what we will say on a given subject because we can't know ourselves until in the midst of saying it. We may be perverse when we can't think of a cogent alternative to a commonplace opinion. Wrongness worries us less than tedium. By sacrificing our dignity, we might at least counter the drag of banality in art talk. One of my intellectual patron saints, William James, remarked that a thinker can avoid error or seek truth, but cannot do both. Another, Baudelaire, wrote, "I cultivated my hysteria with terror and delight." If that doesn't sound crazy to you, you may be a critic. Your potential reflects the type and degree of outsiderness that your life and character have stuck you with, along with an itch to crash the circles of insiders and teach them a little courtesy toward the likes of you. You will tolerate as much loneliness as you can to the verge of panic. That verge is your limit. You have to feel liked by somebody. But most of all, you require a loving relationship with an ideal reader whom you have never met and never will in person, but who companions you constantly in imagination. The relationship is conducted with a full view on the world, but a step away from it, as an exclusive compact of mutual devotion. I'm reminded of a pretty good speech by Shakespeare, which gives symbolic voice to my own fondest wish in this regard, and with which I'll conclude. Lear to Cordelia. "Come, let's away to prison. We two alone will sing like birds in the cage. When thou dost ask me blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. So we'll live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies and hear poor rogues talk of court news, and we'll talk with them too. Who loses and who wins, who's in, who's out, and take upon us the mystery of things as if we were God's spies, and we'll wear out in a walled prison packs and sects of great ones that ebb and flow by the moon." The play's chief villain speaks next. He says, "Take them away." So away we go. Thank you. Okay, now we get to talk about that or not. We can talk about, we can forget the whole horrible experience and go on to something else. So how shy are we in Columbus? Yeah. She's praising me. Don't interrupt. Oh, yippee! Oh, thank you. She likes it. She thinks that way. Beautifully. I think art gets to be beautiful, and I try to be a little beautiful too. You know, it's criticism. I mean, all cultural activities that don't have a a practical cause, you know, are supposed to enhance life. I mean, they're supposed to make it, make things go a little better between the cradle and the grave. And, you know, and I'm always surprised when people don't take that as a duty. Well, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, beauty. Well, it's God, it keeps coming back up, beauty. You know, it is the most contested common word in the language. I mean, it's been sort of under one kind of fire or another for a century. And that's very peculiar. It's very telling. But the problem of beauty is that there's no problem about it at all. It's, first of all, what is beauty? Beauty is a word in the dictionary. Look it up. It says, a quality present in a thing or person which causes intense pleasure or deep satisfaction to the mind. Okay? I know what that means. I mean, if I presume that anyone not clinically depressed, you know, has an intense pleasure or deep satisfaction to the mind on some regular basis. I think it's organic. I don't think, you know, again, if we're not clinically depressed, it is like a little burble of agreement with existence. I mean, that's to me what beauty is. It's like where everything stops for a second and your inner state merges with something outside. Your brain merges with your body. It's always involves the body. It's like there's a little excitation. There's a hormonal element, you know. I think which we feel in our heart, by the way. You know, it's like the heart is a sensitive reaction. You know, when you feel adrenaline, it burns, right? You know, and I think there are subtler hormones and neurotransmitters that happen. I think it's a chemical physical thing. We use the word beauty all the time, and we always use it correctly. It's a beautiful day. You know, we had a little of that. I mean, it doesn't have to be intense. It doesn't have to knock you down. It can be very fleeting. But it's a moment where I think it's a kind of blessing, and it's a kind of feeling that something that exists, that we have noticed that exists, must stay the way it is. That is, it's perfect in what it is. We note it, and we want it to preserve. I mean, that's the seductiveness of art. And by the way, I think art is one of its duties is to seduce. But the secret of the great nudes, of the great Greek sculptures, of the Venus de Milo or something, it's like there is a seductive element, but also a reverent element. It's like we're drawn towards something and held back from it. This thing must not be violated, you know, especially by us. It's protective, even as we are drawn toward. I mean, I could go on. I thought about it a lot because I thought, what's the problem? I mean, you know, the professors on the way to the seminar say, it's a beautiful day, sure is. And then they go into the seminar and explain why you can't talk about beauty and art. I think it had to do with an overreaction, I think, to a kind of Victorian sentimentality, capital B beauty. I don't use it with a capital B, I use it with a small b. And and also a sense that somehow art is, it's the proper domain of art, that art is what's supposed to be concerned with beauty. Art is concerned with aesthetic experience. There are many aesthetic qualities that aren't beauty. Actually, philosopher J.L. Austin in the late 40s wrote a great essay where he proposed retiring beauty for a generation, during which we would concentrate our intelligence on the qualities of the dainty and the dumpy, which are very specific words for very specific perceptions. And if we like to reflect on our aesthetic experience, we will have a lot of words. and we will delight in refining them and comparing them, you know. So it's like, you know, I don't want to elevate beauty above other discourse. I want to just put it right back in, you know. And it is, Dave Hickey had written beautifully about it. Beautifully, yes. He's a beautiful writer. There's a book, The Invisible Dragon, which came out in the 90s. It was brilliant. But his approach was to regard beauty as a rhetorical device, as a persuasive device. It's like beauty is the atomic bomb of rhetorical persuasion, okay? It's like where you don't just gently persuade somebody, you knock them down, all right? and I'm sure you've had that experience. It's like a great ballet or opera. I mean, there are moments where you're just fucking helpless, you know? It's like, gosh, they wish they, you know, you almost wish they'd stop doing it, but then you wish that it would never stop. But this is, you know, I mean, art criticism should be a long, open, rolling discussion about our own experience. The thing about, it scares people. I mean, aesthetic experience is internal in a way that seems kind of crazy. When we talk about our experience or something, it's really, we're sort of anxious. We're checking to see if we're crazy or not. If somebody says, oh, I know what you mean, well, thank God, you know, it's like, I once said that, you know, that an experience of beauty specific to one person means that that person is insane. And to be regarded with, you know, with carefulness. Well, anyway, I could go on about that because I like the subject, but we can talk about something else too. How do I feel the artist's relation to artists themselves? Touchy, dicey. I mean, I talk about, you know what Wilde said, much more boldly than I would, so I had to quote him. But it had to do with, you know, I mean, I did drop out of college in the early 60s, and I never took an art course. But I was a poet, and I went east from Minnesota and worked as a newspaper reporter. So it was sort of poetry and journalism or what I did. And in New York, all the poets wrote art criticism in the 60s. It was in a much smaller world, and the art world and the literary world coexisted to a large extent. And poetry was kind of a big deal for a while. It was absolutely destroyed by intelligent pop songwriting. I mean, it's like Bob Dylan and the Deagles, no more poetry. Like, I mean, to this day, any kid with the chops to be a poet is out in the garage with a guitar, you know. The musically unaccompanied verse is, you know, a very special practice, which I honor the people who do it. I reached a point, actually 30 some years ago, where I didn't know what a poem was anymore, and I thought I'd always afraid that writing criticism would destroy my poetry, and it did, and you know it worked out all right. It pays better, and art parties are so much better than poetry parties. And early on, I was just an absolute hero worshiper. I mean, I just, you know, was felt like this ragamuffin nobody, you know, sort of worshiping the artists, and got to know them. And over the course of years, I had friendships. You know, I hung out with artists and drank with artists and slept with artists. It was the 60s. And gradually realized that the artists are, in a way, the better the artist, the less there is of them apart from the art. I mean, it's almost like probably one of the half dozen great artists I've ever known is like Cindy Sherman, you know, who is the nicest woman in the world. And and she, you know, when people ask her questions, she tries to answer. Completely boring, you know, it's like, she puts it all in the work, all of it. And that's why, you know, why don't we know anything about Shakespeare? I think he was a total pill, you know? I mean, it's like, he put it all in the work. I mean, he must have just been Bill over there, you know? Anyway, well, all the wits, you know, were competing, whom we don't remember. That's a kind of a thing. There is a natural, I mean, I think there's a kind of a natural neurotic relationship of critics and artists. You know, it's like you, the artist wants legitimization, wants certification, you know, and the critic wants the mana, the creative juice, the mojo of the artist, and neither has it to give, because they've given it already. You know? I mean, I gave it to my writing, and they gave it to their art. It's like, what's left? You know, let's get drunk. I don't know. I still have friends who are artists, but they're friends, they'd be friends even if they weren't artists. You know, and but also it's, I don't know. It's mysterious. You know, it's hard. In a lot of journalism these days, I think a hyper ethical thing that you mustn't know the people you write about. You know, and the New York Times is very strict about that. And I think that's ridiculous. As a critic, you've got to be on the scene. I mean, you've got to be part of it. It's like you've got to be inside and outside, because if you're too far outside, you don't know what you're talking about, and if you're too far inside, you can't tell the truth. And I've found that as I get older and lazier, you know, it's just funny. I am now at a point, I'm pretty high on the food chain, you know, it's like, I am welcomed on the inside. For most of my life, I was like, you know, something off the street, you know, it's like, boy, could I have used that entree in the past. Now I just stay home. That's one of the nice things. By the way, it's one of the things I say to kids, young artists, young writers, anyone, you know, aspiring to the big time in New York or anywhere, is that when you arrive, you're a nobody. First of all, you discover nobody has been awaiting you, you know? It's like nobody has an opening that, you know, for you. And that can really hurt your feelings. It can also make you mad, which is good. You'll show them. But, you know, and that you look with rapt envy at people who are somebodies. But, you know, I know how painful it is to be a nobody, because I was for a long time. It's the best time of your life. Especially on a scene, on a competitive scene, because no one will bother lying to you. You don't count. You know, the moment you're somebody, you've heard your last truth. Everybody will try to spin you, as they should, you know. So, you know, the longer you can stick with being a nobody, you'll be glad. Is somebody back here? Yeah. Being an outsider? Well, I guess the fact that I've never studied art, you know, and I feel like, you know, I guess at some point I seem like a fraud. You know, I think for probably the first 15 years of criticism, if I were standing here, I would expect somebody to stand up and call me out as a hoax and throw me out, you know. So I didn't really know very much about art when I started writing about it. If I wrote a column or an article, everything I knew about the subject was in the piece because I learned it last week. It gets patched together. I mean, I sort of have a quilted education, you know, that I filled in. It has to do with ambition. It has to do with artists. I'm daring to claim myself as a species of artist, minor artist. So I'm speaking for us artists. All artists are unhappy people, or they wouldn't be artists. Imagine, you come into the world that is full of things from music stands to galaxies and wonderful things, terrible things, all sorts of things. And you say, okay, this is all very well. Now it needs this. Okay, now it's okay until tomorrow morning. You know, it's like, that's unhappy. You know, you're unhappy with the deal. The universe is handed to you, and it isn't good enough. You know, that's a happy person who would never occur to them that it needs something else, unless it was something for pleasure, or you know, they think, you know, some people think that artists must work for the pleasure of being creative. No, they don't. It is fucking hell for us, you know, and any artist knows it. You know, it's like you wouldn't do it if you didn't have to. And so that there is, I mean, any individual effort, I suppose, you could qualify as outsider. You know, it's like anything that doesn't follow the rule book, you know, that makes it up. I don't know if that covers what you said. Yeah. Good.
One is the William James quote, "A thinker can cultivate something or other, couldn't write quick enough, or avoid mistakes, but cannot do both."
You can seek truth or avoid error. You can't do both.
Why is William James in your pantheon?
Because he's an American philosopher, and he's he wasn't the inventor of pragmatism. That was Charles Sanders Peirce, who was his. He's in a way a popularizer of Charles Sanders Peirce. By the way, if you can read him, it's wonderful. I've tried. It's very hard. God, what a genius. Also invented semiotics, did marvelous work in statistics. But it has to do with judging things by their consequences. That William James, basically, pragmatism is, if you have a question and the alternative answers to the question make no practical difference to life, it isn't even a question. You know, erase, start again. So it has to do with practical consequences. And and you don't have to know why the consequence. You don't have to go into the metaphysics or ethics or anything of judging the consequence. You can do that, but first it just has to be something particular. And that's, you know, the, that's sort of, we Americans have no philosophical tradition, really. You know, it's like Emerson, I don't know, it's always, there's something sort of Sunday sermon about him that's always inspiring, but then it's Monday and you can't do anything with it. You know, we don't have the French Cartesian tradition or, you know, occasionally there's some wave of contagion, usually from Paris or from Germany or Frankfurt or something that gets everybody excited for a while, but then we go out in the streets and we're in America, you know? And it doesn't work very well. I don't know. I can probably do better than that if someone wants to follow up. But yeah. Well, I think what happened is that Leo Castelli, you know, was very careful to listen to Clement Greenberg, and then he killed him. I mean, then he took over. I mean, it became, anyway, yeah.
And now we have the moment of the collector.
Yeah.
So I was wondering sort of, you know, how you might respond to that kind of frame, or if it matters to you.
Where the power is in the art world?
But also, I mean, you feel sort of outgunned.
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure. Yeah, no, it hurts my feelings. I don't know. You know, I have two answers to the question of how does it feel to have power as a critic. The one is defensive, but defensible in that, the test of power, the pragmatic test of power, it's what you do with it. You know, I mean, you have the electric outlet. If you never plug anything into it, you know, it's as good as having no power. And I have no stake in who wins and loses in art. So, you know, I'm not invested. And, you know, I have rooting interests. But the other is that, yeah, I'd like some power, you know. We all would like some. It was a very brief moment. It had to do with, you know, the 50s and into the 60s, when it was still a very small world in New York, and it was still, there was still an intellectual elite, the partisan review crowd, you know, and Harold Rosenberg and Irving Howe, but it was also sort of an illusion. I mean, it was an intellectual influence. I think that, but I hope I have some influence. You know, I would like to make it a little harder for someone to think something stupid than it would have been if I wasn't around. You know, just that will reward me. The commerce took over. There are two tracks of power in culture, and one is commercial and one is institutional. Art is, I mean, it's most most art forms are, the commercial is absolutely dominant. It's, you know, books, movies, records. Institutional is what we used to think of as high art, is museums, opera houses, you know, concert halls, where there are certain institutional powers. And I've always, in a pinch, favored the commercial because it's more dynamic, it's more fluid, it corrects its own mistakes. You know, you know, if you succeed by hype and fashion, you know, you might as well just, you know, 2 days later take a gun and blow your brains out, because it has a really vicious snapback. You know, it's like you can be a star and then you're a has-been. But it is, I don't know, the market is, I just decided to absolutely, you know, like a lot of critics, I spent some years, a few years ago, like sort of agonizing about the market and about how all value had seemed to be reduced to price. And then I realized, you know, good luck to everybody. I mean, it's like, you're crazy, I'm crazy, you know, I just try to remember what my uses are for art, and which does not involve the price, and let it go. Actually, there was a time I used to sort of speak up for the auction market at a time when, I mean, it's really amazing. It's like having money used to mean something different. You know, it used to mean having, you had more money than somebody else, but it was, I don't know what having money means now. I mean, it's like the amount of it, you know, that some people have, it takes all the meaning out of it. It's like, all right, there have been a couple of times in my life, say three or four, when my wife and I have actually bought an artwork, because it was something small, a print, it was something I really wanted. You know, it's like, it's generally something I wasn't going to write about, you know, for some reason. But it just, damn, I liked it. And I realized writing a check is so much more sincere than writing a review. Okay? Because it hurts. I write a review, I get paid. Okay? You know, it's like, I must really mean this. Okay? Okay? But, you know, it's... the people who are buying art now, it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt. So it's like, you know, it's like if their art collections, you know, go tank in, as investments overnight, their accountants might notice with a microscope, you know, in terms of their assets. So it's like a lot of things in the world right now. It just seems to be on a track all its own, you know, and... and it's, anyway. Yeah.
So it seemed like at the end of 2014, writing about Rachel Harrison, you know, there's this really exciting kind of photographer, sculptor,
yeah.
45-year-old woman doing this thing. And then at the end of 2015, it was Alfred Kelly dying, you know, one of the last articles of the year.
Yeah. Oh, but I'm going to be calling. I'm always excited about my next thing to write about. I wrote about, recalling, I did a profile of Rachel Harrison a year and a half ago, which I know she's got this lovely sort of yellow chartreuse sculpture with a grapefruit in it, which made me happy to see. And Elvis Kelly died. It's, I don't know. It's, I mean, you're asking what's hot right now for me?
Is it getting easier to write about? Are you more excited about writing about mid-career artists or
I have, it doesn't.
What's
I don't know. It's always the next thing. I mean, I am a journalist, you know, so it's like we journalists, you know, reinvent from issue to issue. I mean, it's like one of the things that's frustrating about the New Yorker is that they have more critics than they have pages, so I can't be in every issue, you know, and I like, you know, and I wrote for the Village Voice for a long time and for this wonderful magazine that only lasted 2 years called 7 Days. It was like writing every week is easier than writing every 2 weeks. I mean, it's like, it's like a power plant. If it cools down, you got to crank it up again, you know, whereas if it's going, you go to the next thing. I mean, my criterion for writing about something is what will make a good piece of writing. You know, what do I think will bring out something in me that will, you know, be of interest to somebody? And it isn't always the same as what I like. You know, there's a critic, an artist, journalist. I think there's like two criteria. There's quality and significance, okay? It's like how good it is and how important it is, you know? And they're not always in sync. You know, you get Damien Hirst, who I think is extremely significant and a terrible artist. I don't think he even pretends not to be a terrible artist. You know, Jeff Koons to me is actually a very good artist and also significant, but in ways that but anyway, if somebody is only really very good, like a landscape painter or something that, or in a genre that doesn't have a lot of currency, you know, I might on a certain occasion write about it, but it's really like, I can't justify, you know, directing readers to it, you know, because it's just something I like, so I don't talk about it. You know, I might want to buy it if you give me some money. Yeah. Favorite in other fields, we're talking about ballet. Balanchine, you know, was who taught Americans to be beautiful. You know, he came from Russia. You know, with the whole ballet tradition, discovered American boys and girls. He talked about the boys and girls, and how quick they were, how fast they were, and he revamped the entire tradition of Russian ballet around American bodies. I mean, that makes me want to cry thinking it's just, you know, who knew? We didn't know. You know, a bunch of kids running around in the playground, you know, and he thought, ah. but I think that if we go into any other field, it probably, you know, I have no special authority and we can talk, you know. Did you hear Aretha Franklin singing You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman at the Kennedy Awards? It was on, go home and get the YouTube of it. It was just the last one where Carole King was being honored and then Aretha came in and sang, you know, like a natural woman. Killed. You know, that's, I mean, there's things like that that are just, okay, that's as good as anything gets, okay? You know, it's like, you can't be like that because it's, you know, it's on a height. You know, in popular culture, when it happens, Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, you all know Swing Time, the movie. I think that's the first time I got a VCR back in the 70s. I rented a tape of Swing Time and went to, there's a dance pick yourself up, dust yourself off, start all over again, dance, and I just rewound it all day long. Something about dance is the most direct. This is the most direct deliverer of beauty. It's really the one art where the intention to be beautiful is practical. You know, in any other art, if you try to be beautiful, you're just going to do something embarrassing. You know, you're going to do something horrible because it will involve an idea of beauty that is a convention. It's a cliche. Something that was beautiful, but beauty, actual beauty, is always a surprise. Even when you're looking at something that you think to be beautiful, like a great work of art, if it gets you, it's not what you thought. It'll be a new thought. And I know one of the standards for greatness is that it can do it again. It can surprise you again. It can be different at the same intensity. Most art, even good art, you get it once, and then you come back and salute it. But you never have that epiphany again. You know, you like it, and it's like a friend. But a great work you keep falling in love with again and again. But ballet it's a feeling of beauty. It's like a bodily thing, and combined with music. This is just a big, great big conversation. You know, it's like, as a writer, I'm presuming that because I really care and really work at it, and that I have some talent, that when I talk, you shut up and listen. Okay? I mean, there you are. You're shutting up and listening. I'm talking. Okay? That's, you know, and yay, it works. But then I get off the stage and that authority vanishes. And if we're talking about something else, we're talking about movies or something, then it's ridiculous. And I sit, you talk. By the way, I think my favorite movie of the year was Mad Max Fury Road. Anybody see it? Jesus, God, is that good. It had no right to be that good. It isn't about anything, you know. But actually, some critic recently was saying, it was a great article in Tad Friend in the New Yorker, wrote an article about the movie industry now. It's about Fogelson, is a big mogul now, trying to sort of transform the movie business. And said something that's a little sobering, which is that he decided he's not interested in good movies. He likes good movies, and he thinks that good movies are good. But the criterion now is satisfaction. Because American culture now, it goes for satisfying rather than elevated or, you know, aesthetically. And that's exactly what that Mad Max thing was. It just, you know, deep down, it's like, you know, you've got this itch and it scratches it. I remember it was in the summer, I had had a health scare, I was depressed, my wife was out of town, it was hot, you know, and I was just really in the dumps. And, you know, during the afternoon I went and watched the movie, and it was like, oh, okay. You know, and it just, you know, a bunch of trucks, you know, ramming through the desert and shooting people. And Jesus, you know, wow, thank you. Actually, it had wonderful jokes in it. It's fun. I'm a bit of a clumsy handyman in the country, and, you know, fixing things and machines. But there's a moment in the movie where they're escaping across the desert in this giant tanker truck. And it gets stuck in a mire, in the mud, and they've got to be moving, because they're being chased by all these insanos, and there's a tree. It's the only tree we've seen in an hour, but it's a dead tree that's right ahead of them, and it's a perfectly properly equipped big truck, so it's got a winch, you know, a chain that comes out, you know, and they get the chain and pull it out, and around the tree, it's 6 inches too short. They can't close it, and they work out what to do, but it's like, if you've ever tried to fix something, that is exactly the shit that happens, okay? It's always something like that, yeah. Can I talk about painting? Yeah, I love painting. It is my favorite art. It has been in some trouble and some decline and some eclipse, you know, through since the 50s. I love it. It sometimes I think it's like, imagine having a loved one who's in intensive care, right? It's like you don't love them any less, but you can't pretend they're in great shape, okay? With the tubes and things, you know. It's like sort of the great moments in painting since the 60s have been sort of occasioned by the thought that painting is dead, which turns out to be a great way to make lively painting. Starting with Warhol and through Gerhard Richter and Luke Toymans. It will never go away. Like Dave Hickey said, that it's painting is not over except as a high art. Now it is a niche art like jazz. You know, that is, it used to be the queen of the arts. It used to be the peak of Western culture from the Renaissance. It'll never have that again. It got chipped away by other mediums, not only photography. I think probably the novel in the 19th century did a lot to drain energy from painting, the narrative function, and then the movies. There are, you know, I've had occasion to think, well, why is it that painting can't die? What is it about painting that is indispensable and irreplaceable? And I think because there are a couple ways of thinking about it. One is that it is the one human activity that combines our peak sense with our peak capacity, the eye and the hand. In working as one at maximum efficiency. Also, as being handmade, it is entirely elective. Everything we see is chosen and performed on purpose, if you trust the artist. You know, it's like, I mean, one of my sort of rules of thumb about art is, does the artist know what I'm looking at? You know, that is, does the artist have some idea about the art, about what they're doing that is not borne out, you know? Or can I look at it in a way that the artist didn't anticipate? That immediately eliminates a lot of art. But if you trust the artist's critical as well as creative intelligence, every square inch that you see is on purpose. Even if it's a spatter or a drip, it was, you know, they could have taken it out, they didn't. As opposed to photographing, no grains, no pixels, no mediating machine or process, right? No compromise. And so that when you sink into a reverie with a painting, as I was doing with Edward Hopper's Lady on the Bed here in the museum, kind of put a great painting. There's a complete fusion. There's no translation from the artist's brain, heart, guts to yours. you know, it takes, like anything, you know, it takes practice, it takes education, it takes self-education. You know, it's, I mean, I'm naturally going to argue for the autodidact because, you know, everything I know about art, I learned on a deadline. I mean, I'm, well, also for pleasure, but I was looking at paintings before I knew anything about the painters. And trouble with, you know, with art history education is that it fills you up with stuff you've got to unlearn to then really look. Well, big subject. Anyway, but it's, but no, I mean, I have tremendous respect for, well, I mean, you know, I painted some myself. I like to say I painted just enough to have odd respect for mediocre painters. You know, it's like, it is really hard. You know, even making a bad painting is hard. You know, and a great painting is, to me, just in, it's almost not human, you know, like Velasquez. By the way, I think that, you know, Manet went to see the Prado in the 1840s, 50s. It was at a time when the Spanish school was not as well known. He came out of the Prado after seeing Velasquez and said, I wonder why the rest of us bother. And I think I decided at one point that modern art was born when Manet saw Velasquez and despaired. It's like painting had been done. There was nothing to add, you know? And so what can you do? You can quote. And that's what he started to do. I mean, he started working in, you know, a Spanish style, pastiche of like, Zurbaran and Goya, and you know, it's like the self-consciousness that we associate with being modern was born in that moment. But it's if you haven't been to the Prado, go expose yourself to Las Meninas. It's the best. It's the best square footage of anything in the whole world. Yeah. How does beauty fit in with criticism? Talk to this lady. She was saying write beautifully. yeah, I don't know. I think, you know, it's... you can't talk about beauty because beauty isn't a thing. And you know, I want to return to it. Beauty is a phenomenon. It's the name of a phenomenon, of an occurrence. It's when it's something that happens. It doesn't inhere. You know, it isn't there in the dark, you know, and it can be occasioned by extremely eccentric things, you know, the truck scene in Mad Max or something, you know, moonrise over the Walmart parking lot, you know, it's like, I mean, everybody experienced it. I think it's like moments of reconciliation to existence. It's like, you know, where the inside and the outside are in balance. It's without that, you're going to be suicidal. I mean, I think suicide, and having experienced some depression in my life and knowing people are depressed, it's like, it's almost like suicide becomes the only possible beauty. The beauty of this stopping. You know, it becomes really quite glamorous. There's a lot of literature about it. So I don't know. It's just, I wish, you know, somehow in the culture, we've gotten to the point where talking about our individual experience, subjecting it to criticism. I mean, that's what we do. When we make a criticism, we subject it to criticism. We're asking for agreement, disagreement. Is something we just don't dare to do. You know, we want a sense that we'll be agreed with before we say anything. You know, and I do not want to, I'm talking about being outsider. I don't want to pose myself as somebody who's especially brave. I'm somebody who had no choice from the start, okay? The only thing I was an expert at in 1965 was my own experience. I was the world's leading expert in that, nothing else. So I developed a way of doing criticism that put that at the center, and it's still at the center. But it is, and by the way, I did read some academic criticism along the way, and I got kind of excited by how to be really authoritative and hard to understand. You know, it's like, it was nice. Being incomprehensible is a nice, safe feeling. You know, it's like, yeah, nobody can hit you if they can't see you, you know. But, I mean, writing clearly can seem kind of insane. It's like painting a target on your chest, you know. But, again, I have no choice. But here's a thought. Here's a thought which has served me. And I have days, I have moments where I think all art is garbage. It's all a big, insane, probably conspiracy to, you know, fuck us over or something, you know? And it's like every painting is just a dirty piece of cloth, you know, that somebody put some kind of price on, and the hell with it, you know, go out and live in the woods. You know, and I really, you know, and it's, I'm not saying that I'm pleased to think that. It's a scary, deep, it's a depressed thought. But, you know, it clears away a lot, you know. So it's like, it gives art a chance then to grab me and persuade me that at least in this instance, for this moment, it matters. And I mean, that's what it's for. Art is that which makes being alive for another hour a good idea. You know, it doesn't solve anything. It doesn't cure cancer. It doesn't, you know, arrest child molesters. You know, I had a friend who said he wasn't. He had attempted suicide, and he was suicidal until a friend of him said, "Listen, don't talk to me about it anymore. It's boring. Just the next time you feel suicidal, you know, just put it off for an hour and eat some bacon and eggs." And he said, "I did, and I didn't feel like doing it." you know, I think I have a theory that I don't know if they've done a, you know, scientific autopsies, but that I think you could prove that almost that some large quantity of percentage of suicides did it on an empty stomach. You know, I think if you give the body some protein and cholesterol, you know, it's not going to let you kill it. It's going to feel too good, right? No matter what your mood is, you know, it's just, so you're going to put it off. I don't know why I'm drawn to this subject. Okay, yeah. Well, the emotional component in beauty, yeah. No, of course it involves, the thing is that beauty involves the whole organism, I think. You know, and of course there's a feeling that comes with it. It's, I mean, a really engaging beauty, an artistic beauty, and why art does in fact intensify and ramify and deepen aesthetic perceptions is that usually there's some story. There's a story. And, you know, it can be sunsets are incredible. I mean, it doesn't have to be an important story, you know, but it also, you know, I told the story about Balanchine and American Dancers. You know, it's like, it's something that comes to mind that lights up. But were you going to say something else? Yeah. Well, I do consider myself an artist. No, it's because I'm an artist because I'm talented. I'm really good. You know, I mean, I was born. I've got a way with words. I was obsessed with words from a childhood. So you know, it's like. I didn't do it. I can't take credit for it. You know, it was blue eyes, and I've cultivated it. I mean, I think that you know, an artist is someone who, first of all, has a talent. I mean, there is something inborn about it. There's a lot of luck and happenstance in how you grow up, and then there's the will to cultivate and pursue and the ability to tell yourself the truth about it and be honest about when it's working, it's not working, and then, yeah, you're an artist. So, and I mean, there's an art, okay, by the way, it's, Aristotle defined art as a habit of mind concerned with making. And it's a way of regarding existence in terms of the processes and the meanings of making. Taking something that doesn't exist, making something out of nothing or something out of something. There's an art to anything that's done with exceptional skill. And, you know, you can take the art of carpentry or the art of macrame. I mean, it's, and I think it's a bit of a problem that we do. By the way, the language is hopeless at this point. But when I would talk about painting, back in the 60s, still, when you said art, you meant painting. You know, if you meant sculpture, you said sculpture. If you meant photography, you said photography. But if you said art, you meant painting. Now, you mean something within a dotted line that is considered art as opposed to what isn't considered art this week, but next week it'll come in. So. It's very loose. You can't, you know, we use words for convenience, but we're not aware of just how flimsy some of these words are. It just occurs to me, it's like the opposite of beauty. I'm saying that beauty is treated as something general, where I'm saying it's something very specific, okay? Whereas we're talking about art as if it were something specific, and in fact, it has almost no meaning whatever. It's purely a habit of usage of what we call art. It's pretty well dissolved. It attracts grant funding, you know, and runs a market. So are there more, or have we polished off the evening? Okay. Donald Trump, my God, I'm astounded by Donald Trump. I mean, it's like I feel like I'm in another world. It's. I don't know. I'm baffled. It's a huge. I can't explain it. People are trying to explain it. his appeal. Anyone here a Trump fan? Would they admit it? We'll attack you. No. It's fascinating. It's fascinating. It's and Sarah Palin, actually was a title Rachel Harrison used. The Daily News the other day had Trump and Palin on the front page with the headline, "I'm with stupid." Wouldn't that be nice? It demands a whole new story about this country. The fact that he has this longevity, and but what he's good at, which is bullying, basically, is humiliating his enemies, and in a way that doesn't leave him vulnerable. At least it seems to leave him vulnerable, but then it doesn't. You know, it's like it's just a kind of playground trick, which has suddenly been elevated to a godlike, you know, power. And but this is, I mean, any of you probably have better ideas about him than I do. This is beyond my pay grade. So maybe one more, or okay. Do I find myself having stupid thoughts? Never, darling. I mean, perish the thought. No, of course. And also, you don't want to see my first drafts, you know. It's like I can start to seem pretty intelligent, you know, on the third time I rewrite a sentence, you know. The eye of the critic is not the critic, it's not the person, you know. It's an illusion. It's a performance, you know. Like a great actor, you know, is not that person. And also, you know, at the New Yorker, I have incredible editors, right? So who will not let me make a fool of myself unwittingly. They will point out when I'm making a fool of myself, and if I really insist. Which I don't. I read critics with that, you know, to comb out my stupidities, you know. Just reading George Orwell again, you know, who's made a point of combing out stupidities. W.H. Auden, but great critics. I mean, it's like having a personal trainer for your brain, you know. And it isn't even what they say that, you know, it's like when you're reading a great critic, don't underline. You know, you want to underline, you want to take away jewels. No. Listen, get the sound. You know, the intelligence has a sound. You know, it's like, and if you get it, it's like dancing or singing or something. I mean, you get the beat, you move with it. Your mind, you know, starts to imitate it. You know, maybe clumsily, but don't be embarrassed, you know. Intelligence is a pleasure. You know, once we passed, you know, entrance exams, you know, it's like, it's basic justification is pleasure. And, giving and taking it, and letting, you know, things, you know, it's not about explaining things, but it's about boiling it down to the mystery. You know, it's like being able to explain what can be explained, and you reach a point where you come to the edge. You know, you're at the brink, and then it's, you don't know. And that's where art leads us, you know. It's Shakespeare. Velazquez, you know, the supreme ones who I think are, and I think that they had minds that tolerated the idea that art is garbage. I mean, that is, that it's all approximate. It's all, you know, there's no, we're not gods, you know, we're just the stuff we do, right? And but they took it, it's like you, a great line of Shakespeare, you know, the harsh winds do shake the darling buds of May. Darling, I mean, that word, I mean, it just, what? Where did he get that? You know, he was just riding along, and it was like he called the buds of May darling. It's like there's a nuance of understanding of language, of music, that you couldn't, I mean, you feel flattered when you read it because you feel like you can see that. You can see how great that is. You can feel how lovely that is, you know. But then it's almost like there are, in Velazquez, you know, there might be, I don't know how many colors in a painting, you know, almost all of them are gray. Different grays, gradations of gray, you know, gray as a color, black as a color, and you can't believe how discriminating you are in looking at it. I mean, Velazquez is showing you your ability to discriminate at an extremely subtle level, but you almost feel like there are gradations beyond what you see. It's like sounds only a dog can hear. It slides right off the scale. Somewhere out there, Shakespeare and Velazquez are going, ah, shit. You know, but we are not gonna, we'll never get there. And you know, and I must admit, I'm a bit of a hero worshiper. I mean, it's like, you know, they're my stars, you know, and I'm a fan. And you've been great, and thank you very much.